Okay, welcome. I am delighted today to introduce Dr. Mei-Yuh Huang, who is the VP of Engineering of Mobvoi, which I'm happy to let you know that this is a company founded by a UW graduate. Mei-Yuh got her PhD at Carnegie Mellon, and she was one of the core group of researchers who was responsible for really turning around speech recognition in a time where it used to be isolated words and really restricted domains to speaker-independent continuous recognition. From Carnegie Mellon, she went to Microsoft, did a little stint here at UW as a research scientist, and then back as a senior scientist at Microsoft. And from there, she went and founded a group in China that led to the development of Cortana in Chinese. And when she came back here, she got tempted to move to a startup that's working on natural language interfaces. So she's going to be talking about a subject that is near and dear to my heart that we've worked on together. I should mention she's also an affiliate professor in electrical engineering here at UW, and we've co-supervised students together, and she is looking forward to engaging with you guys and talking about this work.
Thank you, Mari. It's my honor to be back here. I worked with Mari during 2004 to 2008. We work on DARPA project together on Mandarin speech recognition. And that's where I met Mobvoi's CTO, who was a great student of Mari. And I can talk about the history a little bit later. Today with me are the other three of my colleagues here, Dr. Puyang Shi. His expertise is in natural language understanding, dialogue management. And Dr. Qingfeng Ye, he's in speech recognition. And Yuanzhe Dong, he's our senior developer who do all the hard work that the scientists don't like to do. I give you two links here. The name of the company, the formal name is Mobvoi, representing mobile voice. So you know what we are doing, just voice recognition on mobile devices. But nobody call it Mobvoi. Very few people know how to pronounce it. The company is known for its first cell phone app. It's called Chumen Wen Wen. That's if you can read Chinese. That's the logo there. What it means is if you want to go out, you want to query some information, ask this app. So in a different way, it's just another personal assistant. And because Chumen Wen Wen itself is a very colloquial Chinese term, so it's got well known by Chumen Wen Wen rather than Mobvoi. And so if you know pinyin, then you know how to spell Chumen Wen Wen, and that's what all this long link is. All right, so why the name NUI, Natural User Interface? I don't see this term to be used by other people much, but I love this term for a historical reason, and I want to touch that briefly. So this is a history about human-computer interface. For some of you, like my age, I would put something even before 1978. When I was a freshman, I was punching cards. I don't know how many of you ever punch cards and have a card reader, just a few of us. And today, you got your mobile phone. It's so convenient. You just put it in your pocket, move wherever you want, and touch screen and everything. And moving forward, this interaction between human and machine is going to be more and more natural and more model. So you got speech input, you may have vision input, and you may have others. And so this is where the natural user interface comes in compared to GUI, the graphic only. And that's where the term is from, NUI. Why NUI? So we see the history. Oh, I like this term, this page. In China, the three biggest internet companies we call BAT, or BAT. That's Baidu, Ali, and Tencent. In US, I call this MEGA. It's Microsoft, and Apple, and Google, and Amazon. But let's roll the clock all the way to 1992. This is a video clip on Good Morning America. And I bet most of you haven't seen this.
Okay.
Well, Joan, this is the first time we've had a computer that can handle continuous speech the way we're having a conversation now. It's also speaker independent,
later.
Which means it can recognize you or me or Kai-Fu or anyone else.
You have to train it to one
and
voice.
It works on a personal computer. This happens to be a Macintosh we're running it on.
That's kind of amazing. How does it do that?
Well, there are two breakthroughs in here. One is speaker independence, which means we train it on thousands of speakers, so it learns what English sounds like from a variety of speakers. And secondly, we have enabled it to recognize continuous speech from a trillion sentences.
A trillion different sentences?
Yes.
All right, now we're going to give you, go ahead and turn it on. We're going to give a little demonstration. I should point out, too, though, that this is not available yet. This is a prototype, and it'll be available in, what, a year or two?
In several years, we think we can turn this technology into products.
All right. Casper, good morning.
Good morning, America. And good morning, Joan.
Go ahead.
Casper, copy this to make right two. Casper, paste. Casper, select all. Casper, 18-point bold. Casper, word underline. Casper, 72-point italic outline.
Casper, open checking. Casper, pay Macy's $65. Casper, pay Pacific Bell, 95.18.
Casper, program my VCR. Casper, record channel 5 from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. tonight. Casper, accept program. Casper, accept program.
Casper, accept program.
Casper, record Good Morning America this Wednesday. Casper, accept program.
Casper, open my calendar. Casper, schedule a meeting with Bob Strong.
What day would you like to meet?
Casper, show this Wednesday. Casper, show this Wednesday.
At what time would you like to schedule the meeting?
Casper, from 2 p.m. to 3 p.m.
The meeting with Bob Strong is scheduled for 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
Thank you, Casper.
Well, I must say that's pretty amazing, isn't it? Okay, this is interesting because we're calling it a talking computer, but what I think is so fascinating is that it's actually a listening computer. Is that kind of fair to say?
Well, that's true, Joan. And I think when you realize that only about 25% of the people use computers all the time, this will open up when it becomes a product. The opportunity for many people to be able to carry a computer around in their pocket or use another personal computer to do things that they would do in their normal life.
Because instead of being intimidating, it's almost going to be like a friend, right?
Well, it's a whole new metaphor for computing, which is a conversational metaphor.
Is it also an all-new software? Is it going to be like a software that's going to adapt to other computers or something totally built into a computer?
Well, this
what
is running...
What day would you like to meet?
Oh. He interrupted you and you're out of time, so people are just going to have to find that out when they go to buy it. Really interesting.
Thank you.
One heck of...
All right. So you heard that, you say someday you can carry your device in your pocket and have this personal assistant. And that's where we are when Apple delivers Siri, when cell phone is everywhere. And it just took 2 decades, even though in the video they were hoping to have that in a year or two. Kai-Fu was way ahead of the curve. But he had this vision all the way. When he came to Microsoft, he funded a Microsoft research in Beijing first, and then he came back from China to US, and he created this division called NUI, and that's where this term is from. Internally, this is the NUI division, Natural User Interface Division, in 2004. Unfortunately, Microsoft executives did not buy that, and he decided to leave for Google. And then that caused a lot of lawsuit and so on. And then everything else is history. Now everybody's AI, everybody's personal assistant, chatbot, and everything. And so with the advancement in technology, especially in neural network, we do truly believe that NUI is here today. There are so many things we can achieve. AI is not about even if today the state of the art, it's not about having a machine as smart as human yet, but there are a lot of things that we can do now, and there are all their products that we are enjoying today. It kind of freeze. So our founder, Zhifei Li, he's our CEO. He worked at Google for 2 years, and he said, that's enough. I know how to run the company. I know what's the key point now. Now I'm going to go back to China, start my own AI company. And he met Xin Lei. Xin is a Mari student, and also at that time, I co-supervised him on the DARPA project. He and Zhifei joined Google on the same day. They were like side by side. Became very good friends. So when Zhifei went to China, he said, well, my AI needs a listener, needs a speech recognizer, and Xin is a guy. And he tried to convince him, After a while, Xin said, okay, let's do it. So he joined a little bit later after Zhifei. And Yuan Yuan is someone that Zhifei met at JHU when, and she's a very great management, and she brings a lot of business into the company. And I just joined them last year. I just celebrated my anniversary a week ago. I now have a quarter of my stock option vested. So here's a brief history. It's funded in 2012. And 2015, in October, we got support from Google. And that's when I say, okay, I finished my Cortana project. I was so excited about Cortana. Actually, I have to, I'm not meaning to brag, but the Chinese Cortana was very successful in China. It brought all this fan about AI. Everybody now today in China, so many stuff, everybody wanted to do AI. But Cortana was initially released on Windows phones. And as you know, there are not many users on Windows phones. And my passion just went all the way down to the toilet. I said, okay, I got to do something to lay out my passion. So I joined them last year. And this is published on Fortune magazine last month. It rate all the AI startup companies across the globe and listed the top 50s. This is ranked by the amount of money the company raised. And Mobvoi is number 18. And actually, in 1.5 days, we have a big announcement coming out, and we will be far ahead next. And I cannot say anything about it yet, and I don't know the detailed content anyway, even if I want to gossip, I can't. The philosophy, Zhifei's philosophy about this company is we want to bring in from hardware to software, end to end. Everything is in-house. So we have our hardware division in Beijing. We also have our own Android operating system. And then in the core of everything is our AI algorithms, speech recognition, natural language understanding, dialogue management, vision, gesture recognition, and so on. And our product starts from something we call TicWear. It's our TicWatch. This is the number 2 best-selling smartwatch in China, just next to Apple. And then we move on to Tick Mirror. So we publish a smart mirror in the car. And now we are working on Tick Home for the home environment. And so this is a brief history about the product we make. And because the major products are all in Chinese, and I think you guys won't be able to understand a lot of the video clips. So I picked 2 of them that you can appreciate a little bit. One is last July, we released English version of TicWatch. This is what I'm wearing right now. And there is a Kickstarter program where people buy the watch at a discount price as a first user. And we made a professional video. So this is better than me running demo here. Mm-hmm.
My first impression of the TicWatch 2 was it fits great and it looks good on my wrist.
Each little point that you touch, it's very specific.
And I like how it goes from being a traditional type function, looking down at it, to really being able to interact with it. My first impression was that it was a neat watch, but outside of that, I didn't really know that I'd explore the functionality or get to use it in the real world.
Normally, I wouldn't consider answering any phone calls while I'm riding my bike, but with the TicWatch 2, you just flip your wrist twice, answer the call, flip another two times, and hang it up. It tracks my workouts, and it fits with my lifestyle.
I'm not really what you call tech savvy, but the TicWatch 2 has been really easy to use.
Okay, Tico, we want sushi.
I can ask it to find a nearby restaurant, and it shows the rating and the review and how far away it is.
Whenever I want to go for a run, I can always track all of my fitness goals on it. It's really important for me to be able to track how I want to do my workout, if I want to use it by calories or with distance or based on my heart rate.
I was really impressed with how convenient it was to schedule tasks and meetings. It responded to my voice commands very easily.
Okay, Tico, schedule a meeting with Bob Williams for 7 a.m. tomorrow.
I thought it was pretty awesome that you could call an Uber by just saying, call an Uber into your watch, and it would request one for you.
It's great to be able to focus on the task I have at hand instead of having to check my phone all the time. If I receive a text, I simply glance at my watch. I can dismiss it until I'm ready to reply later. You know, I don't see how I've really been able to function without it. It's really helped me be more efficient.
It's made my life a lot easier when it comes to my workouts or even just my daily life.
Okay, Tico, how's the weather?
When I'm selecting a watch, it actually matters to me how it looks. It's cute, I like it.
Overall, I was really impressed with the TicWatch 2. It's fast, it's intuitive, it recognizes my voice faster than any other smartwatch I've ever seen. So I get to keep this, right?
Okay, and then end of last year, we are working on something called RoboHome with Foxconn. Foxconn bought a Sharp company last year. And Sharp has this very cute, it's a cell phone, but it's also a robot. Very, very cute. This is very typical of Japanese. I always call them kawaii. It's just really cute. And so the Foxconn CEO saw this machine. He just loved it. He bought one of the robot, and he gave it to Zhifei and said, give me a Chinese version. So we gave him a Chinese version in a month. He was so happy. So we are working on delivering and selling Chinese RoboHome sometime soon. So. Solve it. How do you carry it around? It's really cute, and it's like a personal assistant, but it's also a robot, very cute toy. We currently have about 300 employees in Beijing, and only 6 people in U.S. It's just the 4 of us here in Seattle, Redmond area, and we have another 2 and contractors in Oakland, California. They are working on marketing, that kind of stuff. And we do have a plan to expand. All right, so you see all this product, and I'm going to skip end-to-end from hardware to software operating system. So how do you make something like this possible? Oh, by the way, this is my tick watch, and I want to make sure we end at 11:15 sharp. So let me try to see if this works. Set alarm at 11:15 a.m. Okay. I have a plan to catch, so I'll make sure I get up in time. So how do we make something like this personal assistant available? And so this is getting into more detail, technical detail. This is the pipeline or the flowchart of the end-to-end system. First, you have speech coming, the wave file coming, and then you do speech recognition. Speech recognition just turns the wave into text. It doesn't know the semantics. It's just like somebody who doesn't read, who only can read alphabet A through Z and typing for you, that's all. When we talk to investors, a lot of people don't understand that at all. Or speech recognition, meaning I say something, it understands and takes some action for me. And that's not how, in the background, that's not how the technology work. And of course, I would encourage researchers to look into the end-to-end, speech in and then action out. And everything else in the middle is just a neural net, gigantic neural network. But that's not what it is today. We have speech recognition first, turning wave into text, followed by NLU, natural language understanding. So it tried to understand what topic the user is talking about, what kind of intent. In 1992, you see Casper, it can do checkbook, look up calendar and schedule meeting, and so on. So these are the different, we call domain, that the user want to do. When users say something from the text, you have to understand which domain the user is talking about. What intent, does he want to schedule an appointment or cancel an appointment? And entity extraction is to extract whatever the terms used in order to fulfill the action. So if I say schedule a meeting with Mari, then Mari will be an entity I need to extract. I need to know that it's Mari that I need to schedule an appointment with. So that's the NLU part. And we call it the context NLU because sometimes in order to understand one query, you have to know the history ahead of time. If out of no context, I just say, how about Seattle? Well, what about Seattle? What are you talking about, right? There has to have context. So we keep track of the previous state and feed that information into our current understanding system. And the NLU generate unbiased hypothesis. It say, well, most likely this is talking about weather. How about Seattle's weather? Or another domain would say, no, I think it's talking about flying to Seattle or something else. So we generate unbiased. And all of this task-oriented task coming to this dialogue management, it says, okay, with the probability that it's talking about weather, that's what we're going to do. If this is about booking a flight, that's the next step we're going to do. And so the dialogue management try to assume that the classifier is correct and let's do some action. But this is in the background. And when the answer came back, this would get another layer of information in addition to whatever the NLU unit give to you. And you combine all this information, do a re-ranking at the end. Say, oh, okay, now I have more information. And according to whatever state I am in, I'm going to pick this is what the user's intent is. In addition to the task-oriented missions that we can fulfill, we also offer chatbot. I don't know how many of you heard of Microsoft Shell Eyes. It's a chatbot. It's basically you just randomly chat, how are you, and then you talk you back. There's no task that you need to complete. It's just to kill time. And this is amazing in China. It's not so much in US. In China, because the population density is so high, everybody take public transportation. And if you live in Beijing, going to work, it's very common it takes 1 hour from where you live to go to work. And same thing in Tokyo. So people has a lot of these fragments of time to kill. In the public transportation, they may be reading news, they may be watching a TV show, something. And that's when a lot of people were playing with the bot. And so Xiaoyi's, when it was released on WeChat, it was like a wildfire. It was millions of users in 3 days. And WeChat got so mad, and WeChat shut us down, shut Microsoft down completely. And now we find a way to get it back. So that's the chat. And chat is becoming, originally I really don't like chat. I said, who has time to chat, right? I'm working so hard every day. I love the task-oriented dialogue. This is the mission. This is my core. This is what scientists do. But as I get into understand more about chat, there are a lot of technology and algorithms used in chatbot actually applicable to other useful scenario like customer support and other area. So I don't look down upon this chatbot anymore. I don't have time to chat, but I'm into learning more about chatbot, and we have a small group working on chatbot. Question and answer is like Jeopardy, Watson. So you ask a question, what is Bill Gates' age today? And you have to give you an answer. So depends on what the user say, all of these are possibility. These all fit into the re-ranker. Once the ranker decide, okay, I think the user say this is what I'm going to do. The system has to generate a response to the user. So NLG is a natural language generator. It generates a sentence. Again, it's in text format. Then you either synthesize into speech or take some action, or both. So that's the whole thing. And for Chinese system, everything I mentioned in this picture, everything is in-house technology. English, because we want to ship English watch really quickly. So far, English SR is using Google API. And again, this is just another different view of what technology the company has, since I'm in the software industry, not in the hardware. So software-wise, there's operating system, speech recognition, language understanding, dialogue management, vertical search to search for answer once you understand the semantics, speech synthesis or text-to-speech, deep QA, question and answer, and knowledge graph. In order to be able to provide the answer, you have to have a knowledge graph, say, about the relationship between different objects. And we also build our own knowledge graph on artists, music. This is one of the top queries. And on the other side, we have object recognition, dictation, face recognition, and emotion identification. So like in watch, you can lift your arm and then the screen would come up. Normally, if you are idle, then the screen is dark, it's dimmed, because we want to keep the battery last longer. In the car, in the smart mirror car, if you say, play me a music, and it's playing, and you say, next song, then you can interact with speech, but you can also use gesture, just move your arm over and go to the next song, and this way go to the previous song. So these are all our in-house technology, and these are all the partners that we work with in China. So speech recognition, we use Kaudi. This is an open source software. How many of you heard of Kaudi? Yeah, so if you're not in speech recognition, you would not know. The most popular the most popular software package for speech recognition in history, this stuff from Sphinx, Kai-Fu's Sphinx system. It was not open source. There was no open source concept at that time. But if you join Sphinx Consortium, you pay, I think it's $100,000 a year, you get all the software support from CMU. And then HTK from Cambridge University released their HTK toolkit, and that's also not free. And until Dan Provi, who is one of our genius in speech recognition field, he say, okay, I'm going to produce a beta tool, and it's free. And this is like a revolutionary. Just about every startup AI company use Kaudi as the backend for their speech recognition engine. You can use the system training in Kaudi directly, but to use that to have an end-to-end system, there's still a lot of work. One is voice activation, activity dictation. So when the speech come in, only when the speech coming, you start to run recognizer, right? Otherwise, your watch will be burned out all the time. So there's VAD, and we do that ourselves. This is DNN based. And then there's this we call hot word triggering. So in 1992, you see the hot word is Casper. In today, it's Siri. It's OK Google. It's Cortana or Alexa. These are the hot word. In our watch, it's OK Tico. So we have our own hardware triggering that's also DNN based. And there are some devices that we worked on. The hardware is so outdated that the 14 operations were just too slow. So we have to use different ways to scale it up and convert that into integer operations. And last, the CalD released the most advanced acoustic model called the trend model. And we took that in, applied to our system, optimized our online decoder so that it can run real time, everything. Especially on the front end, we basically rewrite the whole architecture in the front end for CalD. We also are working on adaptation to car environment and home environment. This is different from this we call closed talk speech recognition. This is a lot easier than if you have something on your desktop like Alexa, or if you have something in the back of the room. I don't know if that's ever usable. And then versus if you're in the car, you have a lot of car engine noises. So we are working on adaptation in that area as well. And this is the picture to show what chain model is. Since most of you are not in speech recognition, I'm going to skip this. But this is just internal experiments on our Mandarin internal. This is live voice search data. With the baseline, this is a time-delayed DNN acoustic model, looking at triphone, meaning that when you model a phoneme, you have to look at what phoneme is ahead of it and what phoneme is following it. And because you have to wait until you know what's after you to decide which model to pick. So this has a higher latency. And in the past, each of the phoneme model is modeled by three-state Hinner-Markov model. And each state consume at least 10 milliseconds. So each phoneme has to consume at least 30 milliseconds. And so when your speech comes in, every 10 milliseconds, you extract feature and you do something every 10 milliseconds. With the trend model, first of all, because it's beta, it's more accurate, you don't need to look at the right context. You just look at the left context. So that cut back the latency. And then with the trend model, with this topology, you can finish the phoneme in one frame. So we start to use 30 millisecond time frame. Frame rate. So every 30 millisecond, you do extract the feature and apply that in your search algorithm. This has a 5 to 10 times speed up, with a 20% relative error rate reduction. And this is just quantization. It's for integer operation. Quantization is the term we use internally. I personally don't like this term. It's not really quantization. It's just a scaling. To scale the output from sigmoid function. Sigmoid give you a value between 0 and 1. You just scale it up so that you can represent that with integer. And when you need the original floating again, you just scale it back. So it's a scaling, not quantization. Language understanding, earlier I said we do domain and intent classification. The number of domains we're supporting right now with TicWatch is about 65 domains. You can ask a lot of things. By the way, this is Chinese version. English version has fewer domains supported because we have to build our own understanding system. Only speech recognition and speech synthesis are from public API. And the classification, we originally used maximum entropy. Now we're moving everything toward TensorFlow. TensorFlow is Google's open source. It's a toolkit to use neural network to do your machine learning. If you don't know yet, and if you are interested in AI, you should learn it now. Slot tagging is to extract the entity. It was originally CIF based, and now we are moving to bidirectional as LSTM, again with TensorFlow. And when the statistical model fails, you always have to back it up with a rule-based. Don't think that statistical model is 100% accurate. It never is. Dialogue management, like I said, we have a re-ranker. The NLU give you multiple hypotheses, and we delay the final decision at dialogue management. We also have a platform that will allow us to expand to a new domain with multi-turn scenario quickly. And this is similar to Alexa skill set. developer can come in and add more skill set to Alexa. And we have this tool recently built by Dr. Puyang's team for our internal usage, and we hope we can release this to third party pretty soon and the others. So this is the tree structure management. So this is a roadmap from 2015 to now, from the wearable, that's the watch, to tick mirror. And now we are working on home environment, pretty much similar to what Alexa is doing. And in the future, virtual reality, everybody is working, all the startup, all the AI startup companies working on this. And what's interesting to me, and I think Zhifei convinced me, is that we also have to own the hardware part. 2 years ago, three years before this was released, I was still working in China at Microsoft. They told me, they showed me the prototype, and so it was very neat. But the hardware was going to be produced by a different company, a partner. And they love this product so much, they say, guess what? I don't want to charge you anymore. Let me be part of you. Let me produce the hardware for you. And then Zhifei said, this is in line with my vision. I want us to own the hardware division as well. So now we have a hardware department ourselves. Actually, hardware is a pretty big division. They occupy more than half of the floor in Beijing right now. So I want to take a 2 minutes break to talk about what's AI. And for me, I don't have any doubt what the definition is, but some of the investors we talk to, they say, you guys not AI. Why are you calling yourself an AI company? And I was just really puzzled, what's not AI? What's not AI about Mobvoi? And then he say, well, you talk about your domain. You have to do domain classification. And if you realize a user want to make a phone call, if somebody say, call Mike, the next thing you look up your address book and say, hey, there are two mics in your address book, which one are you calling? And the only way that your personal assistant knows how to do that is because you hard code it in the code. If this is a calling, if this entity has more than one phone number, then or one if there's more than one entity that maps to the name, then you have to ask who you are calling. So everything is hard-coded in your code. So that's not AI. Well, I feel like I was talking to someone who doesn't know programming. Everything is program. Everything is in the code. So anyway, so I want to ask myself, what is AI? And a few months ago, I learned about this TV show called Humans. Any of you knows? It's a TV series broadcasted in UK. And it's showing in US too. And I was curious because I'm in the field of AI. And this is talking about making machine look and think like human. And of course, this is a drama. This is a science fiction. But I want to know, I want to see other people's vision. These are not scientists. But these script writers, they have great imagination. You can learn from them as well. So I start to watch it. So this fiction goes beyond that. It talks about what's the social impact when we reach there. When a machine can think like you, and when the machine serves you every day with your family, at some point you start to feel like he or she is part of your family. You shouldn't treat him as a machine, as a slave. Should you respect him? And the scientists then start to make these machines consciousness, so they can think, they can feel. It's just like a human. It's very interesting fiction. And so I bring this up because I think this is what the investor's mind is, what's AI about. And I'm not from one of those startup companies who go up to an investor and say, hey, I can give you a machine like this tomorrow. So I just honestly told them that, no, that's not the state of the art. We're not there yet. But there are a lot of things we can do today, and you don't want to fall behind. I'm just an honest engineer. So if you are passionate about AI, come to join us and make this fiction a reality. So we have an office, a very small office, like what I say, the four of us, and we are all here today. Our goal here is to attract and retain the talents. You can never hire enough talents. And if you're in the AI field today, you know how fierce the talent war is. It's just, you see how many new labs going on in Seattle from Apple, from Microsoft, Facebook, Amazon, everybody. So this is my alarm. It's 11:15. Sorry, just interrupt my thought. What I find out, the two talents that's very difficult to find, one is speech recognition scientists. I call them endangered species. Speech recognition is such hard work. And I think Mari knows, I know. So I remember when we worked on the DARPA project in 2004. There was no map reduce tool. And you got this gigantic amount of training data. You spread all over the machines and you ran for a day. And for some reason, the Red Hat Linux version just hand. The job's just hand. It just hand. And the rest of 100 sub jobs finished, just waiting for this guy. In hand because he was trying to write in the disk and da, 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 da. Anyhow, it's just such hard work. So a lot of speech scientists actually gradually move on to natural language processing. I'm not saying NLP is not important. And Puyang is very, very important to our company. Without the understanding and the dialogue management, we cannot make an end-to-end system. But boy, this speech recognition scientist is just so rare. It's just extinguishing. That's how I feel. So if you are in AI field and specifically in speech recognition and natural language understanding, we want you, not just we. I'm not advertising for other company. Everybody wants you. We need full-time, part-time, interns, scientists, developers, junior, senior, whatever. Normally, you send your resume to jobs at mobvoi.com. But today, all four of us are here. You got a shortcut. If you sign up in the next 5 minutes, just kidding. You have these four email addresses here, so you can contact us directly. Thank you.
We have time for some technical questions. I should say I reserved room AE108 for any students who want to talk about jobs or technical things. So there's time for that sort of conversation later today, 1 to 1 o'clock, room AE108. But right now, if somebody has a technical question, we'd welcome technical questions for Mei-Yuh. Or vision questions, company questions. Okay, I will ask a question. So what do you think right now is the biggest challenge as you expand to these different domains and you're gonna wanna be going, probably people will be interacting with their watch and then with their home. What do you see as the biggest challenge of dealing with the multiple domains, multiple devices and seamlessly doing speech recognition? And language understanding in these in the grand world of multiple devices?
Wow, that's a big, big question. There's so many angles, so many things that you have to tackle. First of all, my personal passion is in auto, in cars, because I'm from speech recognition background. And I think in the inside the car, that's when you absolutely need speech. All other areas, speech is just nice to have. So I like to focus on auto. And the problem with auto is all the noises for speech recognition. And it's a lot more difficult than even at home. At home, if your children are screaming, you can either move them to a different place or something. But while you're driving, you focus on driving for the safety. And so speech recognition, the tick mirror we have right now has two microphones. If that's enough, we don't know yet because we just released this product. We are waiting for more data to come back from user feedback, from our SI accuracy. We're going to transcribe the data and do an extensive study and see what's the next batch of data we need to collect. For understanding, the way we are doing it right now, you have to do it domain by domain, like the Alyssa skill set. Somebody add another skill, booking train ticket, another one add a book airline ticket, and so on and so forth. And that is useful today. Is there a way that we can do domain independent? And that's the vision. And I would encourage some of you guys in NLP field think about this problem. I personally don't have a solution for that. And Kai-Fu actually just posted a blog in China. And he said three things. And I really appreciate his honesty, because a lot of startup company, in order to get the money from investors, they give you a grand vision. It will be there. This is so glory, blah, blah, blah. But Kai-Fu said something really to the point. He said, first of all, big data. We have all this machine, we have GPU now. We need data. And the car scenario, the data is different from home scenario, from the watch. And if you don't have the right data, it's very difficult to make the machine smart and accurate. So one is big data. The other one he mentioned is about domains. He said, there's nothing that you can do that your machine will just understand everything. You just do one domain each time. That's what you have to build up right now, today, in today's technology. And I think when a company becomes big enough, we do have to look at more long-term research direction. And that's why Thursday after our announcement, we should have a large funding coming in. And we are working with universities and research institutes in China right now to bring a more research component to the company, because we want to look at the vision. But as far as today is concerned, we do domain by domain. Does that roughly answer your question?
Well, on that question, how much are you like beamforming and noise canceling, and how much are you just mass training your networks with noisy data?
We do the Tick Mirror version one. We do have a beamforming chip in there that we use directly. But internally, we are working on this on our own too. And actually, there will be a student coming here working with Mari. That's exactly the area we are working on. So if you are interested, we welcome you to join us and have a discussion and work together.
So how do you deal with security and user authentication? For example, if someone that sounds like you starts talking to your watch right now, would it respond? Or?
So right now, similar to Cortana with watch, you just say the keyword, okay, Tico. And it's supposed to be speaker independent, that's by design. But security is a good question. The Chinese watch today has an NFC feature where you go to a vending machine and you want to buy something, you just scan using your watch and you pay through your Zhifubao, Alipay, directly. And that means if somebody steal your watch, you can access your bank account. So what we do with that to protect user is that as soon as you take your watch off, it will be in lock mode. And you have to enter your PIN number in order to unlock it. The English watch doesn't have that feature yet.
OK, I think we're out of time. So we will thank Mei-Yuh again and people who want to.
Thank you.